like this ocean of time that surrounds us. When we're in there, then we were in there, yeah, we have many, many experiences. Sometimes we remember them as older people, and then oftentimes we have no memory. But it doesn't take away the fact that we were there. It's a reality. And it's an experience. That's part of who we are. Now, recognizing that life can be the absolute best that we make it, and we're the only people who are in control of our life. When we're present, like we're present now, and we have thought and we have experience, it is by choice and not because we have to. We live in this time, moment to moment, by choice. Everything that we do, we should do by choice. Not by habit, and not because we have to. If where you work and earn your living is not fulfilling you inside, not the monetary compensation that you receive. Money is a tool. It's not a God. And so when you look at money as a tool, and it is a tool of exchange or thought, the ability for us to have it or not have it, yeah, put your hands up. We're always in this place of thanksgiving. We're always thankful. But more important, turn your hands over that we share. Because the joy only comes when we share, be it a sharing of self, being it a sharing of exchange of food, water, whatever it is. Gathering is a good thing, and we continue to gather. But, you know, pretty soon your icebox is too full. Your cupboards are too full. And then you have all this stuff. And all the stuff is responsibility. Yeah. And we'd say, pull. Pull whole when you don't use the things that you have that have been gifted to you. Yes, things, pass it forward. Pass it on. Don't hold on to it. We came into this earth, we came to this world in the wombs of our mothers. And when we leave this earth, we're going to go the same way. We're going to be in this ocean of mother of time. We're not going to be able to take anything with us. So why hold on to it while we're here? Only when we share whatever it is that we have as we gather, do we feel a blessing or feel blessed. So that idea of here we are, in the wombs of our mother, in the things that nurture us. Now imagine if you had a wand, a magic wand, because we all have them. We have a magic wand, and we can walk to every single person that we know that has a sense and go like this. Poof. And it disappears. In our life, this is really what we want to do. We enjoy sharing joy. It is a natural thing. It is very natural. When we appreciate everything that surrounds us, we are nurtured by what we see. And it's a feeling that we experience by not only what we see, but what we're able to share. When we look outside and we see the beautiful green, there's something about not just this place that you're blessed to be sitting in, but about the calm, soft breath this place surrounds us with. We're in the womb of our mother. We're right there. So it doesn't surprise me why Elaine chose to bring you folks here to share time with one another. Simple. Bringing us back to what we know. Bringing us back to what is familiar. What is family. We say, Elaine has heard this many times, and many of you that have been here. We are connected by the kaiba, by the oceans that touch each land mass. And they're called the kaiba, or the eight oceans. And so if we have a thought, and we put that thought, and we know that thought is going to travel, it is going to go ocean to ocean to ocean to ocean to eventually it comes back in your mouth. So if you think about the rest of the world, we are affected by every single thing that other people experience somewhere else. The sadnesses, the joy, we are affected by that. If you understand what I was saying about this ocean, you know, we're sharing this ocean of time. And many experiences are happening in this ocean of time. And sometimes you think, oh my gosh, why do I feel so sad? What is it that is holding me down? Oftentimes, it's like you're stuck. It's things that surround you. And the only way you can lift those things up is take care of what's inside. Mm-hmm. Something is making you aware of what is around you, is what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. And when you become aware of that, the only way it can soften or be released, take care of yourself. So lift up your hand. Lift up your hand. I'm doing mirror. Okay? This finger. Say akahai.
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 Akahai in Hawaiian means kindness. Akahai.
Akahai.
And then point to yourself. Oftentimes we're kind to everyone else, but we forget ourselves. Mm-hmm. So in that word aloha, akahai has to begin here. It has to begin with you. Caring for yourself. Don't cut yourself short. Meaning, if you need something, take care of what you need for yourself first before you begin to share with others. Because you have to come from this well that is wealthy. A well that is wealthy, you. So being kind to yourself, fill yourself up with kindness before you go and share it with somebody else. Simple Hawaiian thought. Be kind to yourself first. Second word in that word, aloha, lokahi.
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 Lokahi is family, or the things that nurture you, the things that surround you, the people that surround you. So you take care of yourself, and then lokahi, you're inclusive to all the things that care for you, and take care of you, and become, or are, your family. Yeah. So right here, we are lokahi. Mm-hmm. We're all a family, sharing in this thought of lokahi, or family. So, take care of yourself first, and then you can take care of family, lokahi.
Okay.
Third letter, that word, aloha. Just saying the word, it tastes good. But olu. When someone is olu, their ability just can't get enough of. Yeah? Olu. There are people who are in your life, and when you think about them, there is a smile that comes to your face. Why? Because they're so olu olu. Olu olu is another translation, is to be agreeable. But it really is to be able to listen. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes, as people, we want to tell everybody many things. And we miss the opportunity to listen. I'm saying, olu olu, take the time to listen. There's many joys that come through listening. But olu'olu also refers to community. Mm-hmm. So you have yourself, you have your family, and you have community. And community is your kuleana. Yeah? The things and people who depend on you. Your kuleana. In whatever things that you do, there are people who constantly come to you for help or needs. Mm-hmm. Those are kuleana that you've created. And you're responsible to those things. Just like the community that we live in. We are a part of who and everywhere that surrounds us in the towns or homes or villages that we live. Because they nurture us by doing their punyana, we nurture them by doing our punyana. Imagine if the people who come to take out the recyclables don't come. That punyana becomes your punyana, right? And so you got pile and pile and pile of stuff because that person didn't take care of their punyana for whatever reason. Yeah, we're not faulting anybody. But in a community, everyone has a place and they have a responsibility. Being olu'olu is being able to understand the punyana that you have. Being olu'olu enough and appreciative enough to do it well. And in doing it well, everybody, the community benefits. So, akahai,
akahai,
lo'kai,
lo'kai,
olu'olu.
Olu'olu.
The next one is ha'aha.
Ha
ha ha
ha ha
ha ha ha
ha
ha ha ha ha ha ha ha ha ha ha ha ha ha ha ha. When Hawaiians use something more than once, like a ditto, yeah, a double, they're saying, listen to what's being said, take note, this is important. When things are repeated. So anytime you see a Hawaiian word and you see the word has been repeated right after each other, it's because they're saying, it's a ditto, and a ditto, and a ditto. Yeah? You say et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, to give emphasis. The reality is, when the Hawaiians ditto like this, it is stop, listen, take this into heart. Ha 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 has to be humble. And being humble allows us to understand we don't have all the answers. Being ha'aha is realizing someone who's sitting right next to me, behind me, in front of me, may have a better answer than me, a better response. Being ha'aha is realizing that's the truth. I hear it in what she says or what he says. You know, this is a better way. Being ha'aha is recognizing that others have value too. And so really, what are we talking about? It's about how we value the things that are in our lives, that are important, that help to make us who we are. Being kind to ourselves, we value ourselves. Being kind to the people who nurture us, we value them. Being kind and understanding and appreciative of the community that surrounds me, that nurtures all the aspects of my life. And being ha-ha-ha, to realize that I am going to fall down. I'm going to nick my knee, hit my hip, you know, bend my elbow. It's part of life. But when I stand up and I'm ha-ha-ha, somebody is there to lift me up. Yeah, being ha-ha-ha is also being the person to do the lifting. So, we value. The last letter in the word Allah is Ahunui. Ahunui.
Ahunui.
Ahunui is to have patience. We as humankind somehow have missed out. And when you look at the finger that it is, yeah, in the word Allah, it's the smallest.
Mm-hmm.
But imagine trying to hold on to something without that finger. Balance to whatever it is that you're carrying, as small as it is. You probably could hold things with just the other four, but without this little one, it just doesn't feel right. It's balance. Being ahonui is recognizing that we must be patient, that sometimes the answers don't come right away, and the response doesn't come right away, but there is still value, big value. When we share that thought of aloha, we recognize the importance of every single person in our life, people, and things in our life that help to make us who we are. But it is only when we take the time and we have the patience to open our hearts, to realize the value. So, bring your hands forward. In our hands, we say Aloha. In these hands, we have the ability to give joy. Yeah? And we also have the ability to receive. So when we think of Akahai, Lokahi, Oro, A'aha, Ahome, we're saying, Aloha, come share with me the values of my life, our lives, and everyone that surrounds us. Yeah? Simple. Simple, simple, simple. Not hard. So we don't have a whole lot of books. Books is captured thought from someone else. Captured thought from someone else. And if you're writing a book, yeah. But it's captured thought from someone else. Now you hold in your hands the ability to bring love and joy. Yeah? And you do it by turning your hands over and sharing. So in this gathering of Aloha, the only way to enjoy it is to turn it over and share it. Yeah. Yes. To receive and to share. So thank you for this opportunity of just sharing in a moment. And I know that you maybe have a question, or maybe you have a question. I'm just thankful for being in your presence and being able to experience your breath. Thank you for this joy.
Thank you.
It must be carried out, right? And imagine our world is the sun that it came up. And the way our world has been going, we're blocking the sun, or we create havoc in nature in the name of progress. Now, don't get me wrong, we need to progress, but we can't forget the old ways. There has to be accountability. And so being accountable is being Hawaiian. Being accountable for what you say and what you do, and what you cause, or what you help to create. Yeah. Cause and creation, same, similar words, but one can be very destructive. In the creation of something, there's responsibility. I'm sure when they were creating all of the technology that we have today, that there was true breakthrough. Because we're always wanting to be like God. That we want to be like her and him. All the God. This is what we strive for, to be the best that we can, to be God-like. But we were born to this earth in a simple way. And if we don't always hold on to those truths, we're walking in space with no grounding. Meaning we create things that have no foundation. Being mindful again of the things that you take on, the puyana that you take on. I never understood the importance of the teachers who came before me until now when I'm teaching my grandchildren and great-grandchildren. You know, and I realized how important my grandmother's words were, my grandfather, taking us out to gather hay, so that we would be able to feed ourselves, go out and pick limu. You know, kind of took all those things for granted. Now, a little ball of limu kohu, $7 for a ball this big, you know? $10 for a bag that's a little bit bigger. All you have to do is go in the ocean, swim around the coral, and I can cut what I need, you know? Because we ma lama, the coral reef. But if I went there and just pulled everything off the reef, it wouldn't go back. So I'm glad that I had good teachers that helped me to understand the importance of how we care for something. If I wasn't exposed to that, I probably would do what other people do too, because that's what they learn. Right? So being creative kuleana that you have and the creations that you bring forth is really who you are, what you are. Now, it's come to me twice already in sitting in this room. Some of you have, I'm going to say, bigger than small, sadnesses. And I don't want to point you out, but I'm going to tell you, please help yourself. You're here for all the reasons that have brought you. But I believe that little bit of Huna or that telephone call, email call, Skype, there's so many ways. And even anticipate that phone hanging up. It's okay. Do it. You're going to be so much happier. Address the sadness, address the concerns. And then let it go. Bless it. And let it go. Because that pulls you down from enjoying the time that we do have. I was in Japan last year during the tsunami. And I went there, and when I went, 2 days before I left, my granddaughter had a Japanese pen pal. And you know, the 60th birthday is a big birthday in Japan. And so she tells me, Granny, can you take 1,000 cranes to Shie? Shie was her pen pal. Shie's grandfather in Tokyo. What my granddaughter didn't know is Tokyo is huge, you know, huge. And so when she thought, oh, Granny, you're going to Tokyo, right? Can you take this? I said, sure, I'll take it. But where is it that you're going to go? I mean, he is, right? So we were going to Fukushima and Sendai, where the tsunami came. In order for, and we were going directly there first, in order for me to be able to take this to the family party and be there to play music, happy birthday for this gentleman, we had to turn the trip around by 4 days. And so we did. And we go to Chikasaki, and we're there at the other end, eight and nine towns away from the center. And we're there delivering this, and we have dinner the night before. And the night before, there in Fukushima, actually closer to Sendai, Hamana of mine, they employed this whole village, and the people make all the wetsuits. It's a surf company in Japan, but they make all the wetsuits for the surf company. And so all 85 families in this village work for RLM, which is the name of the company. And so the court is a recognition of how important the people that surround you. You know, if I had known that the next day I would never see these children again, you know, I know them for the baby, I knew her for 3 years and the brother. But, you know, they're family to us. And we kind of always take for granted, oh, you're going to be here, I'll see you tomorrow. My reason for even relating to that story is, if there's all these things, if my granddaughter didn't say, Granny, can you go to Tokyo and drop this off? We wouldn't be there in Sendai. We wouldn't be in Chikasaki. We wouldn't have been in the area that we were. And there wouldn't be any choice. The things that we went to do, the family that received us, received the cranes, they were thrilled to have a Hawaiian group come sing, dance, and play music for them and celebrate his 60th birthday. Mm-hmm. As he said, absolute best. Ichiban, ichiban, ichiban. Mm-hmm. Thrilled that we came, you know? Mm-hmm. And so I'm saying that there is joy in some of the choices that we made. Would I have wanted it to be the other way? I don't know. Truly, I believe it just wasn't the time. You know, it was a time for them, but it wasn't the time. I'm saying to all of you, I didn't mean to bring you down. I want you to celebrate the fact that all these things that happen on the other parts of the earth affect us energetically. It may not affect us because we don't see it. So if people are putting out good energy, we will receive good energy. So we have a punyana to make that happen, to make that happen in that way. We create the energy that surrounds us, that blesses the people that it continues to travel. So to say a harsh word or something that is unkind intentionally, you are creating that. And it becomes a truth in this time that continues to move through the world. When they say be kind in the words that you share, be responsible in what you share and what you do, this is what you're talking about. Because you cannot take it back. Yeah? You cannot take it back. How often do you leave your house and the people that you're with a kind gesture or a thoughtful gesture, or even an acknowledgement? How many times do you walk out of the house not even acknowledging anybody that's there? You just walk out because your mind is so, I gotta get here, I gotta do this, you know. I'm telling you, take the time. Take the time. It is a nurturing for you as well as a nurturing for them. Recognize, even if it's a cat, a dog, a beautiful flower, stop, admire that flower. It nurtures you. Aloha that flower. And then walk out. What a beautiful memory and what a nice essence to leave your home with and come back to. Leave your home and come back to. It's waiting there. All these animals, birds, turtles, that's a turtle, they wait all day to see you. All day. They're at the door waiting for you, panting when you open that door. Their smile and their hearts are so full. Depending on the day you have, you either pick them up and I'll have them. I'm telling you, pick them up. I'll have them. They're just like, they don't live forever. But you want them to have kind memories. Memories. And that's what we create with one another. We create memories. We create joy. And so thank you for creating this time with me and letting me just bow continuously. But I'm so enjoying this time to be here with all of you and to see the familiar hearts and faces. So I know that was a question that I was able to answer. Do you have any questions?
I'm just...
It's amazing. What had happened there on the mountain of Mauna Kea? I remember my mom. She was sitting down where the observatory is below. And I hiked up to the Hula of Mauna Kea, the very highest pinnacle point. There is an aqueduct up there. And years ago, we had gone with my mom. The last time that we went was Mary Mark, maybe 14, 15 years ago. Maybe longer than that. It's got to be 18 years ago. Anyway, we were all sitting on the lookout point. And so my mother said, go up there and close your eyes.
Really?
Close your eyes, Puna, so that I can see what you see up there. And so when I went up this time, I recanted all the people who were with me when we made this commitment years ago. And there is one other person besides myself of the 18 people that is alive today, and that's my sister-in-law, Robin. Everyone else has passed away. So when I was up there and I sat there at that Aku and I looked down through the observatory and I said, oh my goodness gracious, I remember what my mom said. And I did talk with Nathan before I went, and I told him, Nathan, I'm going to close my eyes and I'm going to call you before we go up the mountain, and I want you to tell me if you see what I'm looking at, you know, if you can see the vision. And so he said, oh, I want to try that. So I went up the mountain and I told him that he's never been to Mauna Kea, but when I came home after I went to see him, so what did you see? He said, oh, I saw these different pools, you know, different small mountains, small volcanoes, I want to say volcanoes, but mountaintops that were up there. And he described them, and it was perfect. And so he said, Huna, I did what you said. You know, I thought about you, where you were, and then I just looked at that through your eyes. You know? So I'm saying that in today's time, we all have these abilities to do things that may sound like they're out of this world. But this is all about family, how connected we are as a people. Sometimes when we feel such sadness, and why I'm telling you this is it's oftentimes energetically when you feel the pull or the heart space of someone else. So be very conscientious about what is yours and what is someone else's. Be mindful, and the only way you can do that is akahai. Akahai. Take care of yourself. Whatever it is you need to nurture yourself, you take care of yourself first. And in accepting kuleana for others, be mindful of what you say yes to. Some things are not meant for you to care for. You can be a witness and be present and be a conduit to help things pass through, but you can't be responsible. Not your stuff. It's not your stuff. So, this belly, why I refer to it as Frank Hewitt, who is Ohana to me, he wrote this melee, and the melee speaks about three women, his grandmother, my mother, and my aunt, his Hawaiian mother. So, represented not only in his life but to the people who they touched. That first bird is the messenger. That was his grandmother. Mm. And then the second bird, the Afrikaner, was my mom, who had a beautiful, loving voice. And always when I come to that part of the bird, I screw it up, so I'm going to tell you. Mm. And I always take, I see her flying in her voice, but I think about my aunt, who is actually the third bird. And the idea of the birds and the monies, in this melee, the monies fly, you know, they motion and fly. And birds are referenced to spirit and mm-hmm. angels and, you know, all the butterflies and the dragonflies and all the things that, that take flight, mm-hmm. you know, that we're able to see and be. But that i'ili kolena, the apapane, and the intention that they hold is really why I wanted to share that melody. Because when our hearts are joyous, we're not stuck to the ground. We're not caught in the moments of all of the tug and pull of life. We're free. We're able to express ourselves with joy. Mm-hmm. And I believe that Spirit really wanted us to live a life in that fashion. Mm-hmm. And literally connect to one another through heart space. So when we dance and we move in this fashion, our ability to be the most that we can be and all that we need